level summit. Kong!
In the still of the night, on the beach in the day, hey, you are the reason that we play what we play for you. Honolulu, we play it for you.
How's it, everybody? I'm Kamasami Kong from KIKI Radio in beautiful and sunny Honolulu, Hawaii. Weather person tells us it's gonna be another beautiful day in paradise. Blue skies, white puffy clouds, and maybe a brief shower or two. Hope you got some time to stick around because I have got some great music for you today by Toshiki Kadomatsu. We're gonna get started with a song that's all about a little summertime romance. So sit back, crank up the volume, and get in your favorite cruise position. Imagine some warm waves and a light tropical breeze with the music of Toshiki Kadomatsu. Like the way that song moves, and what a sensational arrangement here on KIKI. The tune is called Offshore, dedicated to all you folks at the beach.
Hello, this is Meg. Welcome to my through the years 80s Japan city pop special. That first track was from an artist called Toshiki Kadomatsu, and one of my favourite city pop tracks of all time, arguably. It exemplifies everything great about Kadamatsu and the city pop genre in general. We're talking shimmery synths, big catchy choruses, groovy bass, funky guitar, and lots of summer beach themes. We're going to dig a bit deeper into the history of city pop a little bit later on, but for now, here's another banging representation of the genre written by city pop legend Tatsuro Yamashita. This is Dream in the Street by Norio Ikeda.
Thank you.
pop emerged in the 1970s, but became popular in the 1980s. Unfortunately, the genre's popularity only lasted a decade, but it was heavily influenced by Western music. And this is exemplified by lots of the tracks either having English lyrics or English track titles. Kind of broadly speaking, the music typically features a bright, clean, polished sound, which is a result of a mix of electronic and analog instruments and different production methods. It's got roots in soul, R&B, and jazz fusion. But kind of what defines city pop in its cultural context is the absence of any markers of Japanese musical identity. So other than the mostly Japanese language lyrics, it doesn't really contain any sort of trace of the conventional Japanese musical characteristics. So no pentatonic scale, no singing techniques associated with traditional Japanese music like enka. Also, the lyrics switch between Japanese and English. So the genre definitely has this sort of transnational flavour. So yeah, hopefully that's a good brief overview. I'll get into it a bit more later, but for now I'm going to play you a track by an artist called Kengo Kurozumi, who was a singer-songwriter from Okayama. This one is called Rainy 246 and was released in 1982. It features a very catchy ostinato, which lots of city pop tracks do. And that kind of repetitive melodic pattern is definitely synonymous with the city pop genre. So yeah, here it is. Enjoy!
Give no amen.
One was Minako Yoshida's soulful, sultry city pop track Midnight Driver from her album Monochrome. So kind of speaking to the lyrics in Midnight Driver, city pop kind of emerged in a time in media ecology that emphasized mobile over stationary music. And this was mainly due to the introduction of the Walkman in 1979, which changed listener behaviour worldwide dramatically. But also cassette decks, car stereos and FM radios were also gaining popularity in the 80s. A lot of this equipment was produced by Sony, which then went into partnership with CBS. And then obviously it emerged as Japan's largest record company by 1978.
Ride on time, sound like you're more in a line.
So people using this new Sony equipment could now record their favourite music on the radio and then drive to the beach or go to a summer resort while sitting to city pop in their car stereos. And many of the city pop tracks reflect this in their lyrics, with kind of frequent references to cars and roads, but they're also produced in ways that make them easy to be consumed as sort of background music. So I guess city pop is urban music primarily in the sense that the main intended audience consisted of these kind of affluent urban professionals who had their own cars and could definitely afford all of the equipment that was necessary to enjoy and I guess take part in this cultural movement. City pop genre also kind of has no trace of any sort of political messages or frustrations about society. And this sort of apolitical nature is also why city pop is also called the sound of the bubble genre, which was this age of economic optimism in Japan, where the values of post-war consumer society were fully embraced by lots of people. But it's also the product of this 90s, 80s environment that also gave way to the decline of city pop, and as it lost its popularity in the latter half of the decade to rock bands and then to J-pop in the 90s.
Hi, honey.
Although the genre arguably died in the 80s, it's definitely made a resurgence in recent years. This next track by Miki Matsubara, released in 1979, made a comeback during COVID, when many Japanese teenagers took to TikTok to sing the song with their parents who would have grown up listening to it. This song actually got to Spotify's Global Viral 50 for 3 weeks running. And when you listen to it, you'll see why it's so popular. But for me, it kind of represents the timeless nature of this genre, which kind of just makes you feel happy. Most of the people who made this track have now sadly passed away, so I guess it's really special that it's made a comeback. But yeah, this is Stay With Me by Miki Matsubara.
グレイの車
Summer Breeze by Piper, another massive city pop group. Just going back to the influences of city pop, the genre is probably easier to identify through its visual characteristics rather than its musical qualities. A lot of the cover artwork on lots of the city pop records was influenced by pop art artists like Andy Warhol, and most of them kind of depict summery beaches and swimming pools, and I guess these are kind of from the perspectives of those who enjoyed city pop and who were kind of benefiting from this economic boom at the time, kind of visiting the beaches and enjoying the seaside resorts in Japan. We also see kind of a lot of cover art that depicts the big city theme implied by the genre, showcasing skylines of maybe Tokyo and Yokohama, but they could equally be New York or LA, which kind of echoes back to the point I made earlier about the transnational flavour this genre kind of encompasses.
Bye.
last one was Kanpu by Yumi Murata, released in 1983 on the label Fat. This next one is going to be the last track. I hope you've enjoyed listening to my very brief introduction to 80s Japan city pop. An hour doesn't really give you that much to showcase this absolutely fantastic genre. But make sure to tune in to the other Through the Year specials coming up. There's defo a lot of good ones, so defo worth listening to if you like digging deeper into the sort of musical ecology stuff. And finally, I wanted to sign off with one of my top 10 tracks of all time. This is by city pop artist Junko Ahashi. She released this in 1984 on her beautiful album Magical. It's a city pop boogie fusion track and it is absolutely superb. This is Dancing. Enjoy, guys.
Now, but his hand is caught in his own pain.